Welcome you back to the Patrick Netherton Show right here on 1130 The Tiger. He's Rogers. I'm Patrick. Our Netherton Show coaches caravan for 2021 is off and running. We mentioned Frank Selfo, Southeastern Louisiana, tomorrow. We've got Broderick Fobbs for Thursday. We got Brad from Grambling. We got Brad Laird of Northwestern State on Friday. We've got Lance Leipold, the head coach of Kansas, joining us next Tuesday. Old friend of ours on the Brando Show. And speaking of an old friend, guy I hadn't gotten to talk to in a couple of years now. Obviously, the COVID year kind of messed everything up. He is the head man of the Louisiana Tech Bulldogs, one of the best in the business, and just one of the best dudes in the business. Skip Holtz joining us. Skipper, how are you, brother?
I'm doing great. How are you doing, Patrick?
Man, I'm fantastic. You and I haven't had a chance to talk in a bit, man. It's last year was kind of a pretty insane year all the way around. All right, so
I would agree with that comment 100%.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And the crazy thing is, Coach, the off season has been so much more about off the field things than on the field things. Obviously, the Texas and OU stuff, the name, image, and likeness stuff, the COVID stuff. Let's start with COVID, though, because, you know, this is a battle that coaches are fighting. And, you know, guys like Mike Zimmer with the Vikings is fed up. And Ron Rivera with the Washington football team, they keep talking about how fed up they are and, you know, trying to get guys vaccinated. I'm curious, these are adults. These are folks that can make their own decision by and large. But what are your conversations like with your team regarding vaccination, COVID in general, protocols, all of that kind of thing? What kind of convos are you having with these guys?
Well, it's a balance, because we all want to play, but we all want to be responsible and do the right thing here, not only for each other's safety, but for our society that we live in and our families. And we want to protect everybody with what we're doing. And so it's really hard. I mean, we are very fortunate. We have a large percentage of our team that is vaccinated, but it's not everybody. And there are some things out there that are, I don't know, I think we need to just continue to educate. There's a lot of fear out there about, what about the vaccine? What do we know about it? What are the long-term side effects from it? In order to do it, I don't think anybody is saying, I want to spread the disease, or I want to spread, you know what I mean? So I want to spread COVID and I want to be irresponsible, but I think there is some fear in it. So we have to do everything we can to educate our young men, but ultimately it's got to be their decision. But as a football coach, yeah, I think we'd be sitting here living utopia with 100% vaccination of our football team and not having to worry about contact tracing and major outbreaks and things like that along the season, as we went through last year and had, I don't know how many games canceled and then added some others, but we had to go play games without 28 players on our roster some games. I mean, because of contact tracing and on campus, our student athletes live in four-man suites, and if one person gets it, then the other three are contact traced.
Right.
I mean, so everybody's trying to do their part, but it is difficult. It is hard. And I want to respect everybody has the right to their own decision with what they're doing with the vaccine. But I certainly think it makes life a whole lot easier for everybody when everybody has it.
Well, and it's also, I've talked about this a good bit, and the NFL seems to be leading the way. Benefit of the doubt is gone if you have to lose a game or whatever because you've got COVID. It used to be, oh man, that's terrible. You had to play a game without 28 guys, contact tracing, you lost a game. Now it's, oh well, you did something wrong or irresponsible if you don't have enough guys to field a team. And the NFL is going to, if you can't make the game, it's forfeit time. It's no longer, we're going to try to reschedule everything. Does that make it, I guess, even more pressing for you and your guys, because the benefit of the doubt is gone, and chances are if you miss a game because of COVID, it's no longer, hey, that sucks, and we'll try to figure out a way to make it up. It's, oh, well, that's a forfeit.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard, and I get it. I mean, I certainly understand that we have something out there right now, and what the percentage of work is, I don't know those statistics or those numbers and how effective it is, but I certainly know that we have something out there that can help us.
Yeah.
And having something out there that can help us, you'd love to be able to take advantage of it and not have to deal with it. But that's where we are right now, and I think we have to do everything we can just to try and help continue to educate our players.
And so another off-the-field thing that, I mean, you're not, Coach, you're not getting to coach your guys right now. We're having to do life lessons and and things like you're having to become a doctor, and now you're having to become a lawyer slash agent for these kids, because we're in the era of name, image, and likeness. Louisiana has some of the more relaxed NIL laws. Talk to me about the discussions you've had. I know compliance does a lot of this kind of stuff, and a lot of that becomes their sort of the clearinghouse. But what are the discussions you're having with your kids in terms of their ability to now profit off of their own name?
Well, and I think the name, image, and likeness, I think it's a great concept. And I think for these student athletes that have an opportunity to market themselves and bring in a little extra income, I don't have a problem with it. I think, how out of control does it get? How crazy does it get? I don't know. I mean, I think right now for colleges, we're not allowed to be involved in the process. The thing that we are trying to do is educate our players and set up the vehicles in order to give them an opportunity to be successful with it. We are trying to do everything we can to get them their image and likeness, the photographs from games, to do everything they can to build their reputation or to build their image on their social media platforms. And so we're trying to do everything we can to educate them what's out there, how to go about it, what's the proper way to do it, because I think everybody thinks it just becomes Wild West and it's ready, fire, aim. Everybody's passing money around. But there's a process to it, and it's got to all be documented, and it's all got to be legit and upfront, and there's a process that you have to go through. And so we're trying to make that platform as easy as we can for our student athletes so they can benefit from their name, image, and likeness.
Do you think is there an advantage or disadvantage, or do you even know, to being in a smaller college town like Ruston versus the LSU kids who are in Baton Rouge? Now, granted, they're LSU, so, I mean, they're already going to have some name, but, the Vandy kids that are in Nashville, right? It's a big town. You're not going to – maybe there's – is there – do you feel like there's more opportunity? Maybe there's more of a connection in a smaller town, or vice versa? Do you even have any idea at this point?
At this point, I don't know. I would be guessing and trying to say, well, there's more people in a big town, so obviously that would play as a major benefit. But you also look at, like you mentioned, Vanderbilt. Well, when you get into Nashville, there's also an NFL team there. Mm-hmm. People more willing to get involved with professional sports than college sports. So I don't know. I think there's a lot of things that we're going to have to let the dust settle for probably a couple years and go through this. And I think we're going to get a much better idea what this landscape looks like probably in a couple years when everybody starts to settle into this is how it's going. I think it's new. It just started. It's kind of like that new restaurant that just opened. Mm-hmm. It's always got a long wait, and it's really, really crowded. But 3 years from now, you can walk right in and eat.
Well,
so I think we're just going to have to let the smoke settle a little bit as we get through this and do the best we can to manage it, and then we'll get a much better idea of what the landscape looks like and how it's going to affect everybody on a day-to-day basis in a big city or a small city.
Yeah. Well, feel free to tell the Davison family I'm available for name, image, and likeness deals if they want to spend some of their money over here. Talking to Skip Holtz, the head coach of the Louisiana Tech Bulldogs. All right, let's actually talk about your team on the field now, because we had to cover all the off-the-field stuff.
Yep.
So I didn't get to talk to you last year. You pried a kid – I say pried a kid. I don't know what the conversations were like, but you brought in a kid whose name was literally on a stadium at Abilene Christian, and
yes,
it's his family name on the stadium, and he comes to Louisiana Tech to play. Luke Anthony, who was at Abilene Christian and did a great job there, and I was told, and obviously you can back that up, it had nothing to do with nepotism, the fact that he was the starting QB at Abilene Christian. We saw it when NSU would play them. So give me a read on the quarterback position, Anthony and Allen, and kind of where you're at right now with these guys.
Well, I thought Luke, came in and had a really tough assignment a year ago because he comes in, there's no spring practice, there's very little fall camp, and you've got to go play a season. And he had very little preparation and ended up rolling time with Aaron Allen. But he was still, even with all that, he was the newcomer of the year in the conference. I thought he had a great year. Unfortunately, at the very end of the season, he had a pretty tough injury.
Yeah.
At TCU, where he broke his leg. And we were all expecting a full recovery, and we were going to go into the season with Luke Anthony as a returning and Aaron Allen, and you still had J.D. Head and Caleb Holstein on the roster. So with four quarterbacks, I felt really good. But as we got into this in spring, it looked like that Luke was hitting some complications and getting ready. He had a little procedure done in June. And at that point, we felt like we needed to make sure that we were going into the season with three upperclassmen quarterbacks and a freshman in Caleb. And so we went and we hit the transfer portal and we took a transfer quarterback, Austin Kendall from West Virginia. He went to Oklahoma out of high school and then went to West Virginia. And we signed him and he has come in here and I'm excited to watch him get on the grass when we get on the grass Friday and see him throw it. I haven't even seen him throw it live yet. But I like our two young guys. I think they're going to be really good. I know Aaron Allen had some bright spots. He had some highs and lows last year at leading the drive in the UAB game to take that into overtime and win. And then he comes into the bowl game and I think tried to do too much and threw three interceptions. And then we ended up losing that football game. And so I think the young guys are going to be really good. But I'm excited for Luke's return and I'm anxious and hold my breath on when that's going to be. But really anxious and excited to see Austin Kendall as we get into fall camp. So it's probably like, I think when I look at this football team with the number of transfers we brought in this year, and we brought in 13 transfers on this roster because of roster management. We signed 16 freshmen a year ago, and if you go sign another 16 this year, then you would have 32 freshmen on your roster because the NCAA said last year didn't count.
Right.
And so we already have 16 freshmen that are sitting there. And so we signed 9 freshmen and we signed some upperclassmen transfers. And I think we've got an awful lot of talent on this team. I think we have an awful lot of depth on this football team. But just how it's all going to play out is going to be interesting and exciting. And that's why I'm so excited to get started with practice on Friday.
You mentioned the transfer portal and now the NCAA putting in the one-time penalty-free transfer, which was the case in just about every other sport except for football, men's basketball, and baseball. But now the opportunity for you to go out and get guys, like you mentioned, does managing a roster in college now become a little bit more like an NFL free agency type of deal? Or can you still look at it as, all right, we still need our core of freshmen. We just look at the transfer portal for a few guys here and there.
I think it's a combination of both. I think every year your team is going to be different. You're going to have different needs. But there's no doubt the transfer portal has become free agency. And if you lost a couple upperclassmen and you needed to fill a hole, the only opportunity you really had to do that was to go sign a junior college player. And so I think now there's a whole other world out there in the transfer portal. I think it's the same thing like we talked about name, image, and likeness. I believe there were 2,500 players that went into the transfer portal this year, something crazy like that. And there's a lot of them that aren't going to get out.
Yeah.
There's a lot of them that don't have anywhere to go. And I think it will start to calm down. I think it was like the new toy and everybody's like, oh, I'm going to get in the portal and I'm going to go be recruited again. Well, when you get in the portal, it's a niche. It's a niche. I mean, you have to find somebody that is looking for your position and you fit that bill. It's not people aren't recruiting the transfer portal. You're trying to fill your needs in the transfer portal. And so I think same thing, it'll start to settle down with where we are, but I think it's a valuable asset for a lot of people, especially as you talked about when you refer to it as free agency. I don't think you can scrap the way we've built this program and trying to recruit high school players, bring them in, redshirt them, develop them, get them ready to play so that when the seniors walk out the door, those guys have been in your program 3 years and know your offense and defense and understand how you're going to do things. So I don't think you can abandon that and just make it a kind of just a conglomeration of 85 players from 85 different places every year. I think you still have to build your core and your nucleus with your football team, your high school players that you bring in and grow and develop, and you have to hit the transfer portal just to be able to fill some vacancies or some needs you might have that are pressing that need to be resolved for that season.
Talking to Skip Holtz, Louisiana Tech head coach on the Netherton Show Coaches Caravan, and he's number one. He gets the first slot for the month of August. All right, Coach, you mentioned the quarterback battle. Give us some names offensively that you think are going to pop, guys that we should be looking out for when we're watching Tech.
Well, I think the running back position is going to be really interesting. When you look at, we've brought in three transfers at the running back position with three players that were already on a roster. So when you look at it, I think there's a lot of new faces there, but I really like Marcus Williams, Keon Henry Brooks from Vanderbilt. Marcus Williams is from Appalachian State. Kevin Dominique's from Grambling. And I think Harlan Dixon is going to be a really talented player. I think there's a lot of talent in that room. It's going to be interesting to see how that resolves, that receiver. You've got some marquee names that are returning, guys like Smoke Harris, Griffin Hebert, Isaiah Graham, that I'm expecting to have great years for us. But you also have some newcomers. I think a guy like Trey Harris is one of those freshmen that came in and developed, and what he did this spring, I think his name is going to be heard this spring. I think he's got a chance to have a great year for us. And guys like Juwan Johnson, I think there's a lot of talent in that room. But I certainly think we have some weapons. What we've got to do is just get everybody on the same page and get everybody pulling in the rope in the same direction. And during the off season, we added a new offensive line coach, and David DeGuglielmo, who came from the NFL. He's been in the NFL 17 years, which I think is a welcome addition to our staff. And I think he's doing a great job of really building the camaraderie and a spirit and a unit there with that offensive line, with some stability players coming back that have played in the past, like Josh Moat, Nate Delphin, and Byron Roussel and Walker Hankinson. But we also have a handful of new faces that are going to show up in there. Kelton Hollins from TCU just transferred in as a senior year. I think he's got an opportunity to make an impact. Sam Williams transferred from ULM. So I think we've got a good mix of players on the offensive side of the ball. There's just so many unknowns, just like I believe Austin Kendall is a very, very talented player.
Right.
We just hadn't seen him play yet. So I think we're going to learn a lot about our football team here in the next 25 days of fall camp.
Yeah, you got a lot to learn. Defensively, Coach, obviously you have to replace a whole lot in the back end. You had some really star players, Amik, of course, being tops among them. Tell me about just the defense overall, but also trying to come up with that backfield that can play somewhere to the level that those guys were able to play.
Yeah, when you look at losing L'Jarius Sneed, Amik Robertson, mm-hmm. L'Jarius Sneed went on a great year with the Kansas City Chiefs. So I think we've got some holes to fill back there, and we were not very good defensively. We had a new coordinator in David Blackwell. I don't think he had the same opportunity. We had graduated 7 players the year before, and all of a sudden the true freshman, Cedric Woods, has to step in, ended up having a great year for us. The emergence of B.J. Williams, Jaden Cole did a really nice job from West Monroe. I mean, we had some really talented players back there, but we also have bolstered that and bringing Balaam Buchanan from Tennessee, bringing in a transfer from Arkansas, Miles Mason, and Elijah Hamilton from Vanderbilt, 3 guys that all played in the secondary in the SEC.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you add those to the Cedric Woods, the B.J. Williamsons, Jaden Coles, and Khalil Ladlers, I think our secondary has an opportunity to be much improved, which it needs to be in order for us to be the type of team that we want to be. I really like what we have at linebacker right now. Tyler Grubbs was a freshman All-American a year ago, a freshman who came in and just really made a huge impact. Trey Baldwin's going to be a senior. And same thing I keep talking about, I like the depth there. When you start looking at guys like Cody Fulp was the name you're going to hear a lot of, mm-hmm. Max Carabin, Walker, Alan Walker. So I like our depth there. But probably where we're the deepest, we have probably very few names. The Milton Williams, who just got drafted, is gone. Willie Baker comes back, who was one of our marquee players from 2 years ago. But we have a lot of really young, talented players on the defensive line.
Mm-hmm.
So I think when I look at this team, the biggest thing I see talent. But at this point, it's all how we're going to play together. And if we can get these guys to give up their individualism for the good of the team and come together, and we help these start pulling the rope in the same direction, then I think this team has a chance to be really good. But it's certainly going to be something that's going to have to come together in the next 30 days.
Last thing, Skip, is it a little interesting, maybe odd, I don't know, to have arguably two of the top two families in college football within, 20, 30 miles of each other now, with Terry being over at ULM and you being at Tech? I mean, that's to me, honestly, as a guy who loves good stories, that's a pretty amazing story to have you guys right next door to each other.
No, it really is. And I've had an opportunity to talk to Terry a couple of times with him being over there, and excited for him and the opportunity that he's got to turn and really jumpstart that program and get their legs back underneath them. And obviously, I worked for Coach Bowden. That's where I was a graduate assistant. He gave me my opportunity in this business. So I've known the Bowden family for a long time and very close with them. I mean, shoot, my father, when he went on his honeymoon, they ended up staying at the Bowden's house down in Florida. So
that's great.
And my father and Coach Bowden are really close. So it's neat to see him there at ULM, and I wish him the best of luck. But it is pretty neat. It makes it we keep talking about it's a small world. And here we are 30 minutes down the road from each other as we're both about 35 years later in our career.
Well, make that game happen, Coach. We all want it.
I thought it was going to happen last
year. I know.
And I was really excited with all the cancellations, with UNLV was canceled, Baylor was canceled. We had so many games that got canceled during the course of the season. And the same with ULM. And we both had an agreeable date. And I thought we were all systems go. And I was really excited about it. It's a game that needs to happen.
Yeah.
We're 30 minutes away from each other. We're both playing Division I football. I would much rather keep that right here, have the two alumni close together, a lot of banter back and forth, an energetic game. The fans will come. I think it would be a great venue, and I'd love to see it. I thought we were going to make that happen in Shreveport last year,
yeah.
But unfortunately, COVID got involved, and that wasn't able to happen. But I was certainly looking forward to it.
I was telling everyone sort of jokingly, of course, Tech and ULM would agree to play during a pandemic. That's the only way Tech and ULM would agree to play. It had to be that way. Skip, you're the best, man. It's been too long since we chatted. Best of luck to you guys coming up this season, and we look forward to catching up with you before too long, man.
I agree. Take care of my man Rogers. I appreciate y'all.
All right. Skip Holtz. You know we will.
Bye now.
You know we'll take care of Hambone. Skip Holtz, head coach of the Louisiana Tech Bulldogs.